Good morning. Thank you all so much for coming out. And especially to those of you who managed to make it here from DC. I can't believe that, I think this is the ongoing game of every time there's one of these events held, there is bound to be snow in DC that spites all of the DC folks. So we're super grateful for all of you who managed to come out this morning. I'm gonna get this started in part because we have a guest here this morning who unfortunately is going to have to leave us. So I wanna make certain that he gets plenty of time with all of you. So I want to give you a little bit of context of how I got roped into this. So 6 weeks ago, Nicole Wong, who's over there, you want to say hello, she calls me up and she was like, hey, might you be willing to organize a conference? And I'm sitting here going, what do you mean? And she's like, well, the president has just asked John Podesta to lead a comprehensive review of big data and privacy. And the folks at OSTP were hoping to engage experts and the public. And we thought it'd be really great for you to host one of them. I was like, when? She's like, immediately? And I was like, oh no. And I have to say that the first thing that came to mind was like, there is no way I could possibly do this. I was about to leave on a book tour. I was, you know, running around trying to do a lot of different things. And I knew that I was only in New York City for all of 4 days in March. And she's like, well, why not one of those? And somehow I managed to agree to do this. And part of the reason why, not only because I absolutely love Nicole, but because I actually thought it would be a great opportunity to really bring together people to think about issues that had been plaguing me for quite some time. As some of you know, I have started this process of trying to embark on beginning a new research think and do tank here in New York City called the Data and Society Research Institute. And so I turned to, you know, my two partners in crime, Seth Young and Ellen Menlo, and I'm like, you think we can put together an event in maybe like 6 weeks? And they were like, oh, sure. And sure enough, that is what you've managed to come to, is an event that we have put together pretty quickly with an absolutely astonishing group of people here today. And so for that, I am deeply, deeply grateful. Part of it was also that it fed into another project that a group of us were working on. My colleagues, collaborators, and friends, Helen Nissenbaum, Jeff Bowker, and Kate Crawford, we'd been proposing a project for the National Science Foundation around a council of big data on ethics and big data ethics and society. And so we decided that this would be a perfect way of streaming that in. So all of this is to say that this event is this great opportunity, great time for a whole slew of reasons, and we're really excited to have all of you here to be a part of it. I have to say that over the last 6 weeks, amazing numbers of people have just really stepped up to the plate to be helpful, and so I want to thank all of you for really coming to the table, and I'll go into that more later this afternoon. But I'm just really in awe of everybody's willingness, and part of it is the realization that these issues are front and center for this community, for the public, and for these questions of what we understand in terms of governance and what we understand in terms of the responsibilities of government, corporations, and the civil society. Data is at this point poised to transform every sector, from healthcare and education to national security and marketing. The implications are not contained just in the public or private sector. Both will be affected alongside civil society, journalism, and a variety of different enterprises. Furthermore, the implications are going to be entwined, blurring any boundaries that we have between sectors and domains. The understanding that there is a sector of just like healthcare data is going to be completely muddled by all of these issues that we're dealing with. And so it becomes really important to start to tease these things out. Now, vigorous debates are already underway in certain domains, but there are many social, cultural, and ethical issues that we haven't even begun to tease out. In a society that's obsessed with individual rights, we're dealing with data that is fundamentally networked, complicating any understanding of control that we've ever had. The questions of, you know, what kind of data can benefit the research and the public good come up against the ways in which that data can be abused, and that becomes a huge problem for trying to tease that out. Questions about who should serve as caretakers, who can actually hold caretakers accountable, what are the roles of different kinds of organizations, different kinds of entities, how do they come together and have the same language for even talking about it? How do we talk about inequalities? How do we talk about the ways in which there are asymmetries and who can use this data for what purposes? What are the implications that will happen in terms of data with regard to discrimination and already existing structural inequalities? How do we grapple with those questions of discrimination? Who should be a part of that conversation? Now, these are just a few of the conversations that are intended to spark today. And as all of you who've gotten a look at your sort of assignments for this afternoon have noticed, there's a lot more questions than there are answers, which is part of the fun, is that there's an amazing collection of people in this room. And the reason we brought you together is because you approach these issues from a variety of different angles. You come from industry, from government, from civil society, from the academy. You have knowledge from a variety of different domains, including but not limited to technology, healthcare and medicine, finance, civil services, and education. Among you, there are computer scientists, lawyers, social scientists, activists, data analysts, entrepreneurs, journalists, and a variety of other folks. All of these perspectives really need to be in conversation with one another, which is one of the reasons that we've architected today to really start conversations and to allow people to actually sit and brainstorm and think together. And we will do that in a variety of different ways throughout the day. But as we turn to the content of the day, I want to ask a few questions. I want to ask a few requests from you. Our goal for today is to really push the boundaries, to go deeper, to think harder, to really question what we mean by big data and the phenomenon that's unfolding, to question the challenges ahead of us, the opportunities that you know could be unleashed because of these technologies. But in order to have this conversation to be as productive as possible, we need your help. I need you to ask hard questions. I need you to interrogate assumptions that we have. I need you to play your own devil's advocate, to basically think about ways in which you can flip your own questions on their head. But I also need you to be respectful and help channel the people who aren't in the room. We've tried to bring together a diverse collection of people, but obviously there are voices that are not present here. And we want to be thinking and thoughtful of those voices at every turn. Everyone from this room will benefit if everyone is sort of willing to push back the sort of obvious tropes and the obvious conversations that have been having and go try to go as deep as possible in all of this. For this reason, we also need all of you to participate. And that's one of the conversations I've had with many of you before this. This is not an environment for observers. We want you to really be present. We want you to ask hard questions. We want you to question everything that's being discussed. You are all here because you are amazing as individuals. Some of you represent organizations and are part of institutions, but we don't have you here because of those organizations or institutions. Please be here as individuals, and please be respectful of everybody here with their individual perspectives, rather than assuming that they're always speaking on behalf of their organization. And really, you know, acknowledge that as part of the conversation. Finally, have fun. This is a great opportunity to bring together a really interesting group of people. I love all of you, and I'm really excited to see you all together. It's like bringing together parts of my world in fun ways. So I want you to learn from each other and really get an opportunity to do so. So I'm going to sort of switch to some housekeeping before we turn it over to John so that he can give us sort of introduction to all of this. Today's schedule is really structured to provide different opportunities for conversation. We will begin with an open discussion with John Podesta, who will tell you more about his thinking and the project that this is sort of feeding into with regard to the government. We will then turn to a series of fire starters who are there literally to start fires. The goal is to get everybody talking, scratching their heads, engaging about different issues. They're here from a variety of different approaches, which is part of the goal. In the midst of that, between two segments of fire starters, we will make certain that your tummies are fed, and we will break for lunch, and we'll show you the directions on how to get there. There will be an hour for lunch in which you will be encouraged to meet new people. And then we will return to those fire starters before embarking on a moderated conversation that Nicole and I will sort of get you going in different ways. And then we will break out into the workshops for which you've all received packets of information to really engage with one another on. And those workshops are structured with having a rapporteur who will really help you make certain everything is recorded and two facilitators to make certain the conversation will happen. At 5 o'clock, we will break and we will all transition into a public hall so that we can have a really provoking panel conversation and keynote from Nicole as the evening that will be available. So some basics to know about how to make it through today. The bathrooms are out there. You probably have been able to find them. There are signs. There's going to be food and drinks at all points. So if you need to dip out to get caffeinated, we understand. And feel free to sort of jump out and ask any questions you have. For everything logistical, we have Ellen and Sarah. Ellen Menlo is right there. If you have anything logistical, Sarah is currently out there. Sarah Smith, they'll be on call for anything. The other thing is that can I ask the rapporteurs to all stand up and just wave their hands? So all of these folks, they all know this building inside, outside, backwards. So if you need anything, sort of point to them and they can help you out. You will notice that we were all wearing red lanyards. That's really intentional. Finally, Tamara and Alex also are here sort of to help out if there's anything you run into. You will also notice that you have colored ribbons on your badges. This is to identify you within your workshop group. So feel free to identify other people that are a part of your group. Please note that we will be videotaping every aspect of the morning, including the fire starters and the moderated discussion. We will be making all of this available to the public. That is very intentional, so be attentive to that. We will also be taking photographs throughout the event. If you don't want your photograph to be distributed, please let us know, and we will make certain that those photos are not put up publicly. Finally, you are welcome to talk about this more publicly, this event. This is not meant to be locked down or contained. This is meant to be a space where we can engage the public writ large. But be really respectful of the context of this environment when you're putting things out on Twitter. Just be attentive to the fact that there, you know, there are people who wanted to be in this room. We could not accommodate everybody. I believe everybody has access to the Wi-Fi. There are passwords around the room, so if you need anything. Today's event is also really jam-packed with lots of goodies, so be attentive to time. Finally, I want to turn this over to John Podesta, who I'm hoping will come and spark a conversation amongst all of you. He'll be sharing a little bit about how this project unfolded and giving you a sense of it. And this is a great opportunity for you to ask questions. So as he's talking, start thinking, because he's going to want to engage you as soon as possible. John Podesta is currently serving as the counselor to the president. His duties include overseeing climate change and energy policy. In 2008, he was the co-chair of President Obama's transition team, where he coordinated the priorities of the incoming administration's agenda, oversaw the development of its policies, and spearheaded its appointments of major cabinet secretaries and political appointees. He's the former chair of the Washington, D.C.-based think tank Center for American Progress and the Center for American Progress Action Fund. Prior to joining the center in 2003, Podesta served as the White House Chief of Staff to President William J. Clinton. In January, the president asked him to lead a comprehensive review of big data and privacy. It's in that capacity that he's with us today. Please welcome John Podesta.
Thank you, Dana. And let me begin by saying happy St. Patrick's Day. And I think that this is either this project is either star-crossed or blessed, because we've had two big public sessions, I guess, with universities, both of which occurred on days in which Washington was shut down by snow and the government was closed. So, depending on your perspective, if you think it's really good for at least the federal government in Washington to be closed, we seem to be bringing about that effect. I want to begin by thanking a person who I've never heard anybody whose moniker starts with the amazing Dana Boyd. Everyone refers to Dana Boyd as the amazing Dana Boyd, but I want to thank her. And as you could tell from that brief history of how she got involved with this particular project. She is amazing and has pulled together really a great group of people, and I think a really solid group of papers with that are pointing the direction forward for the conversation today, but also will be extremely helpful in the review that I'm going to tell you a little bit about. I also want to thank the NYU Information Law Institute. There are a number of people, my colleagues from the government, from the White House, from the Office of Science and Technology Policy, from the Commerce Department and NTIA, who are with us today. I unfortunately going to have to duck back to Washington a little bit earlier than I thought because of the snow to meet with the chief negotiator for China on the climate negotiations going forward. So I apologize for having to talk a little bit and then take questions and duck out. And in that context, I think what I should do is be brief so that you can, I think, both give me some feedback. I'm open to hearing your perspective as well as ask me questions. But as Dana noted, this project, this 90-day review of big data and privacy that I chair, and I'll talk a little bit about the other players who are involved, came out of and following the review that the president undertook that included an outside review panel on the questions involving government surveillance, particularly in the intelligence context. But during the course of that review and after the report of the President's Review Group on Intelligence and Communications Technology, the so-called PCLOB, I was stumped. No, PCLOB, that's the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board, and an internal review in the White House. The President spent a lot of time on the technologies, again, as they relate to security, terrorism, law enforcement, and intelligence. But I think it struck him that these new technologies really have much broader application, and that it was worth taking a dive into where's the technology going, what's the future, and is our policy framework that's been developed in this administration, really going back many administrations through the development of fair information policy practices, does it meet the challenge of this new world that we're looking at? And so he asked me to lead this group. I'm doing that along with a number of senior government officials, Penny Pritzker, who is our Secretary of Commerce, Ernie Moniz, Secretary of Energy, John Holdren, who runs the Office of Science and Technology Policy at the White House, and the head of the National Economic Council. The baton has been handed from Gene Sperling to Jeff Zients. So you have probably, some of you have dealt with a number of these people, but we have a short time frame into which to really answer those questions. What's going on technologically? Where is this going? Is there something new about big data? Is it a set of buzzwords, or is there something fundamentally that's being altered in the way that we collect, store, analyze, and retain data in this sort of new environment? And we began that process. Sort of in parallel, the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology are also doing and will report sort of simultaneously on their take, particularly with respect to the technological development. They're engaged. The so-called PCAS that's co-chaired by John Holdren and Eric Lander. They're engaged in really doing. We think we're doing a deep dive on the technology. They're trying to really do a deeper analysis and look to the future about where the technology is going. This builds as I noted on some policy initiatives that the administration had taken in earlier days. First of all, we've made a big commitment in the administration to put more public data out through the Open Data Initiative. So the realization that the government is holding stores of information that have public utility, that if they're out in public, available to academics, to the private sector, to use those big data sets in ways that show opportunities for greater value from the public. That's been a commitment that the administration has taken back to the beginning days of when Obama got there, and it continues. Later this week, we're doing the first of a series of data releases that relate to climate change, and the first one involving sea level rise, so that communities and individuals can take that data, and people can write applications to that data that deal with the need for resilience. So we've got that notion that that putting more data out into the public, letting it be used and available is an important trend. As I said, we also, during the course of the early days of the administration, developed a consumer data policy blueprint that was released in 2011, and that updates the FIPS, was accompanied by a Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights. That work, again, continues to go on, particularly through multi-stakeholder groups that are run by the NTIA. That's a foundation that we're building on, and we're asking ourselves, as I noted, what is new about big data, and do those policy principles that are embedded in that blueprint, do the trick in this new environment? Are there new policy questions, both for the public sector, because its use of big data is now profound and growing, as well as for the private sector. I'll give you what we have kind of not struggled, but we've worked to create a definition of what we think big data is, because people use it in different contexts. And the definition we're using is that there are data sets that are so large, so diverse, so complex, that the conventional tools that would ordinarily be used to manage data simply won't work, that you have to use, that the volume, the diversity, the velocity, the value of big data is beyond what has traditionally been viewed in developing these fair information practices. Let me just say a couple more words, and then let me open it up for comments and questions. I think that I mentioned the set of papers that were developed. I think they're very helpful in posing the questions that are unique in some ways to big data. I would start by saying that what struck me is the ubiquity of collection now. If you go back, even though Dana gave me a kind of a long introduction, when back even further in my career, I worked in the U.S. Senate for mostly for Pat Leahy, who now chairs the Judiciary Committee, and worked on data privacy questions, and particularly in the development of the Electronic Communications Privacy Act. If you go and back into the 70s when the Privacy Act was being developed, I think that the premise of the development of that structure and the way we think about data privacy and data rights in that context is that there was a data collector who was in comedy with the data subject. Now you have ubiquity of collection in a context in which the data subject, if you will, or someone who's giving up personally identified information, quite often doesn't even know that they're doing it. So I think that's one challenge. That that's particularly exploded in the geolocation space, but it'll I think that's a exponentially growing phenomena, that the way we interact with the world is sending off data that can be identified with an individual. I think another trend that I see is the difference between what I would describe as predicated searches. Remember, I come from a legal and particularly from a background of developing law around law enforcement access to data. But predicated searches, in which you might not know the name of the person, but you know the subject of the search, and you're looking for an individual, versus non-predicated pattern searches. Sort of fundamentally, I think, shifts the paradigm of the way both, again, companies and the government can relate to information that has been collected for one person, or but used in a somewhat different context to develop patterns. I think it probably is not overstated to say that through the use of sophisticated analytics and the collection and the use of data sets across spaces, sometimes people using big data analytics can know more about me than I know about myself. And that I think challenges the sense, not just of privacy, but of personal integrity. And that's I think at least different or somewhat new. then there's the question of that I think is front and center in at least one of the workshops and in one of the papers, that the inferences that one can draw and the connections that one has in the world can be drawn out and taken from, but are not always that, and the use of those inferences are not always well understood. And so that's, I think, another factor that we need to think about when we look back and say, does the data privacy blueprint that the administration has been committed to, does it fully undertake and carry forward the challenges that come from that? Challenges to vulnerable classes, challenges to with respect to discrimination. There are ethical issues embedded in this that I think go beyond, go beyond privacy. And that's what we hope to scope within 90 days. We don't expect to change the policy in such a short time frame, but we do intend to at least draw a little bit of a picture of where the future is going, what questions need to be asked, what policy needs to be developed if the current framework needs to be looked at anew, and what research in particular needs to be done that helps us both understand the kind of social phenomena here, the relationship, the power relationship in these new technologies, and also, which really was explored at MIT, the ability to use technology to kind of preserve the important values of freedom and privacy, an open internet, and the free flow of information. Are we thinking enough, spending enough, doing enough research on the ways in which technology itself can be essentially a friend to preserving those important values? So that's a slightly long-winded version of what we're up to, and we look forward to the input of the day, but any input that you have right now, and I'm happy to take some questions.
Mm-hmm. And I'm curious if you all have a bias about things like HIPAA, which regulates classes of institutions rather than classes of data. If you think you're going to leave that model in place, which allows for essentially novel institutions to work with healthcare data without being covered by the law, or if you imagine rearticulating that bargain, how you think you might do it?
That is... I wish I had a good answer to that question, really. I think that one of the things, particularly the individuals who are involved and the excellent papers that have been developed, have, I think, forced us to think that question through. It's not where primarily we have been looking. Obviously, the issues around discrimination, et cetera, that stem from the ability of apply big data to healthcare information have been in our minds. But the structure of regulating at the institutional level versus thinking about how you protect health information at the more meta level, I don't know, against entities that essentially don't get covered by a regulatory model that looks to an institutional arrangement is something that I worked on HIPAA when I was in the Clinton administration, so I can't say it's a matter of first impression for me, but I think we need the capacity for people who are around the edge of that system to basically do the same kinds of things that HIPAA is intended to sort of provide safeguards on is something that I think is we'll need to reflect on and probably need to react to in the report. But I'd be interested in any solutions to that question too, if you have them.
Hi, I'm Helena Sundbaum, and I'm the director of the Information Law Institute, and I just wanted to welcome you. NYU on behalf of the Information Law Institute to say how very pleased we are to join with Data and Society and Dana, the amazing Dana, in this event. But I did have a substantive comment. I mean, there's much that I could respond to in addition to the definition, because I'm hoping that maybe we'll do some work on that today. But the concern about saying something like big data is this new thing, and I know the White House has been very enthusiastic about what we can earn and learn from big data, not only about individuals. On the other hand, because there's this enormous promise, I'm concerned from the perspective of the ethical values, including privacy, that the bar is very low. It's to say, let's just gather the data, and because there's the inductive dimension of big data, let's see what comes out of it. And so there aren't enough, I don't think we have enough principles to be able to say, this is where we put on the brakes, or this is how high the bar has to be in order for you to go ahead and collect your data, not just go ahead and do it because this is such a promising technology. And so, and this is just a hope for what we will be doing for the rest of the day, but also for the White House to resist that kind of reasoning.
Well, it's just say two brief things. One is, the first question we always ask is there anything new about big data? So I think if we're gonna suggest a path forward, I think we actually need to answer that question. And as I said, I gave you a little sketch of at least some things that I think challenge the existing paradigms about the way both the government and the public sector and the private sector and the academic world treats data in this context. So that's the first point. And the second point is that I think that it is precisely this exercise, which is to try to apply the values against the promise and say what's the value framework in which you make choices. I'll give you an example that we talked about. We had a meeting with a bunch of researchers at Carnegie Mellon on educational data that's been used to improve performance. And there was a specific study. They house essentially a big data warehouse of student performance that's made available to education researchers and how it interacts with particularly online technology to improve performance. They did an experiment with respect to STEM teaching, and with particularity towards teaching algebra to middle school and early high school students. And they had tremendous performance results. But when we asked them whether they collected demographic data, they chose not to. Now that was a choice. One could argue that would have been useful. They concluded, I think, that they didn't need it, and that it raised a host of questions about how one would analyze and handle and deal with it from an ethical perspective, and that they could show performance across a broad range of socioeconomic categories with data in which no one had collected any demographic data underneath it, by looking back towards larger aggregated populations. So I think that was actually, I'm teasing that out because I think that, I don't think there's a yes-no answer. I didn't think you implied one, but there's obviously not should we rush in or should we lean back. I think the question is what's a framework around which if you're gonna apply analytics to large data sets, if you understand there's the capacity to re-identify information that's been anonymized, what's your obligation to the context in which the data was collected, and particularly for children, for other vulnerable classes, what kind of safeguards are in place to get the right result?
So one of the original differentiators for big data was the volume, variety, and velocity that you mentioned earlier. my concern is, as people are redefining what big data is, from a functional point of view, what I see emerging and the architectures that I'm working within, what's unique about big data is that at an atomic level it's becoming more and more autonomous, and that to the extent that it's autonomous by self-describing metadata, it can be both a problem and a solution. So to the extent that we can have tight binding of provenance and permitted uses to the data at an atomic level in the form of metadata, to me that is profoundly unique in the evolution of managing large data sets and may be more unique than the volume, variety, and velocity itself. I'm just curious on what your thoughts are.
Well, I think that's an excellent point. I've had some discussions about whether that's kind of a redefinition of what of transparency. That if the technology can perform that function, then you can carry and the data subject, if you will, can access that. Then going forward, data collected for in one context then carries with it the ability to go back and reanalyze whether there's real consent. And I don't know that one can anticipate that consumers can handle that on their own, but that at a minimum you can at an organizational level or by binding to people who kind of think and worry about this, that you can at least have the ability to track data through. So I think it's an extremely important point. One question is, with all of this, it's the dramatic reduction in cost of computing power, of storage, and then the rich use of the analytics. But this is another factor in which I think if you had this conversation a couple of years ago, people would have said, well, you can't do that. It's going to weigh down the system, cost too much, et cetera. But I think that trend opens up the possibilities that you're describing.
I think Corrine. Corrine?
She's my former colleague. I got a call on her.
Really glad you're doing this, John. We call you amazing, the NGO world, so don't feel left out. I know your charge is to conduct this review, but I was wondering what's next after that.
Well, if our idea is not just to write a newspaper story, right? Which is what the president wants is, okay, is there work to do? My guess is from our preliminary conversations, the answer to that's going to be yes. And then what is that work? And it comes in different buckets, as I mentioned. One is additional policy development. I think we'll probably have something to say about the government's use of big data and what its framework should look like. Dana used a word. There she is. Not ombudsman, but data. Custodian, is that what you use? No, you just curate. I think we'll have caretaker. Who's the data caretaker in the public system, and we may have some things to say about that. I think we'll have to again the earlier review was in the context of intelligence, more specifically. In the intel world, although it flipped into law enforcement, particularly with a collection of large metadata sets that can be held by the government. So I think we have to think about whether more policy needs to be developed there, and then what's the research agenda going forward. So I think we may have a bit to say about all those things. Ultimately, we'll come back and I think have to assess Does the current privacy framework, the Consumer Bill of Rights, and do we need to do more there? Do we need to at least beef up and consider that? I didn't say, and I'm neglectful in that We have engaged also with our international partners. One of the things that the president asked us to do was to ensure that we keep that we try to build an internet that's free and open and that keeps the free flow of information going, and that we can find a way to engage in this context. In this case, that's primarily been with our European colleagues, Canadians, and the data authorities in Mexico. But I think it's a larger, more global conversation as well. So I think we'll have a need to say, how do we reconnect? The European Parliament just yesterday voted to blow up the US-EU arrangement with respect to handling data, particularly the safe harbor provisions. Now that's a more or less a scream more than it is a way to kind of effectuate change of policy in the Commission. But obviously we got some work to do to kind of rebuild trust across the entire platform and system.
Corrine actually stole part of my question about the steps, so that was a good pass, I think. But just curious to dig a little bit deeper about your comments on the blueprint. There were several, I think the White House got widespread support when they published the blueprint and the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights. And I'm a little bit concerned about suggestions that we kind of start from square one or any kind of inference that somebody may make that we need to do that. The principles have been around for a while.
Yeah.
There might be a need to emphasize more rather than others. I think injecting, like the civil rights community recently did, the notion that we have to look at the ethical, go beyond just the privacy considerations and look at the ethical considerations if there's digital discrimination and things like that. You know, kind of following up to Corrine's question, I mean, do you see kind of almost an addendum to the Bill of Rights and then a call for legislation? I'm trying to, if you could dig a little bit deeper maybe onto kind of next steps in that regard, where that there might be need not just for more research but for more consideration on the policy side.
Right. Well, I tried to answer that, but maybe inadequately. I think that what I was saying was that I do not anticipate we will propose the policy, but we will point in the direction of the need for policy development. And I think that the principles that are in the blueprint around control, transparency, respect for context, security, access and accuracy, focus, collection, accountability, those are all, I think, remain solid, smart, well-tested principles, both in the American context and in globally. And enforcement mechanisms that we have in the U.S. have been at least as robust as we've seen but from other governments. So I think those things are all retain saliency, and I think what we want to think about is, and I can't be more specific. I'd be jumping in front of my colleagues if nothing else. What we want to think about is there anything that needs to be tweaked? Is there anything that needs to be added? And I think that these questions around we got a couple today already, in the questions in the papers are full of them, which around use, particularly with respect to discrimination and other things, with the issue around health information and the application, the framework for that. I think those are all things that we need to think through, and I can't prejudge where we'll come out, but they're important. I think that the deliberations today will be important in helping us shape what we want to address and what we think we can just leave to the side.
Yeah, so as you may be aware, it's Sunshine Week. So this openness is definitely a topic in a lot of people's minds. I can say that the other side of open data is the Freedom of Information Act, and the AP just came out with a big analysis that said you all are turning down more requests than you're granting at the moment, and that when I talk to lots of journalists, the amount of redactions is going up too, and the use of exemptions. Now, if we're going to take as a premise that journalists and the media are an important watchdog over the use of data by the administration, right, particularly the use of algorithms, there are two questions. One, are you looking at any guidance to the Justice Department or other law enforcement agencies around the enforcement of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act against journalists or any other entities that are accessing or using data, even in embarrassing ways? And are you also considering the use of FOIA to get access to data or, in particular, potentially down the road, algorithms and code that is being used by public sector or quasi-public sector institutions to make important decisions?
All I'm doing is taking notes. I think with respect to the former, with respect to the first part of your question on the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, I'm trying to understand the context of that, but maybe we could follow up separately and privately. But for those of who don't know it, I have something of a reputation of being a advocate of more open data policies, and particularly in the fight to make sure that FOIA is not only on the books, but effectuated. So I haven't seen the AP study, but I'll go take a look at it. I'm not sure that's within my range of duties, but I will try to make sure that we take a hard look at what's going on. In general, I think the administration is, as I noted at the outset, has been tried to be a friend of openness and push forward on policy initiatives that really provide more data. So I guess we can always do better. Want to take the last one?
So the Privacy Bill of Rights and the Privacy in a Connected World document are like 2 years old. You have a lot of access, the rest of us don't, to conversations and to attitudes within the administration. What have been the bits of evolution over the last 2 years where you've seen minds change or you've seen perspectives change on some of the topics that were discussed in those documents? Has there been any new information or new perspectives where they've said in the last 2 years, maybe we need to add some nuance to this or change the direction?
It's funny, since I've only been there for the last 2 months, it may be better to ask some of my colleagues here during the sessions about whether they think that the conversation has really shifted from where it was 2 years ago. There have been, obviously, the NTIA, as I mentioned, has tried to take forward some multi-stakeholder codes of conduct forward. They've been successful with respect to mobile devices. They're doing facial recognition now. Less successful with the do not contact piece. So maybe that's informed their attitudes or thoughts about the way the policy was originally developed and where it stands now. But you got a bunch of them here, so I'll leave them to answer that question. Thanks.
Unfortunately, John has to leave us now, but I would say thank you so much for joining us this morning. So next up, we have the opportunity to get some fires thrown out here in fun and exciting ways. And so we're going to sort of bring people up one at a time to get people sparking, and then we'll do this for a little bit, and then we'll go to lunch, and we'll come back. First up, we've got Tim. Where are you? Come on down. Who will hopefully entice us with really fun thoughts about cognitive security.
Great. Hello. Everyone hear me? Great. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Tim Hwang, and my talk today is entitled On Cognitive Security, and excited to give the first kickstart this morning. In the next 5 minutes, I'm going to sort of tackle three topics. In the first one, I'm going to talk a little bit about one particular aspect of big data, particularly regards to the landscape of sort of influence and persuasion online. In the second part, I'm going to talk a little bit about where that landscape might be going. And then finally, give a little bit of a thought about what that means in the role that governments and platforms play in this environment. So first, a little bit about me. As I mentioned, my name is Tim Hwang. I'm a researcher at DSRI working on the social architecture of intelligence systems, which is a very broad research agenda, but we're looking into the regulation around things like the use of Watson for medical diagnosis, high-frequency trading, autonomous military systems, and trying to derive sort of principles for sort of policymaking in the space. So I'm going to begin today by actually beginning with an observation, which is by now perhaps blindingly obvious, but just to set the scene, which is that much of the big data that we talk about when we use the phrase big data actually refers to social data, right? Whether you are a Facebook or a Twitter or even a user of those platforms, you have enormous amounts of access into how people behave, right? And the behavior of groups at scale. And one perhaps not surprising upshot of this, right, has been that data has increasingly become a way to test hypotheses and research questions about social systems, which until this moment were purely speculative. But I think one thing that's sort of been less well remarked upon is the extent to which these new understandings give us tools that we can leverage to influence social systems and the implications of doing so. So that's a little bit vague, so let me give you some concrete examples. So did many of you see this 2012 study? James Fowler and a number of others worked on this study essentially with Facebook. The idea was when you logged into Facebook, you'd see an image showing you which of your friends voted. And the idea was to see whether or not they could effectively use peer pressure at scale to get people to vote. The upshot, not surprisingly, is that it works, and they estimate something on the order of 340,000 votes were sort of turned out by the use of this system. Another example, one that I'm personally involved in, is working on this sort of pervasive meme online that vaccines cause autism, right? Kind of a big public health issue. And what we're doing is we're leveraging existing research about how misinformation spreads through social networks. And the idea is to use bots, automated identities driven by software that exist on social networks and are basically constantly scanning the social environment for what's being said and when it's being said. And the idea is when it detects the appearance of this kind of pervasive, pernicious sort of meme, the bots execute a series of countermeasures, right? Either they message the person directly saying, no, that's not correct. Or more interestingly, they try to mobilize other people to actively challenge that idea. And the theory is essentially to create sort of a missile defense system for misinformation online. And we've been seeing some really interesting results. Now, if you're of a certain mind, this is pretty worrying, and there's a certain sort of death ray type element to this technology. And I think what's increasingly interesting to me is the extent to which these technologies presage a kind of emergence of an idea we're calling cognitive security, essentially the idea that in the future, these techniques are used competitively, that people are using it to both find exploits in sort of compromising and manipulating social networks, and that people are developing techniques to actually shield social networks from influence in this way, because after all, the two techniques I showed, there's no necessity that they're always used, for example, for the public interest, nor are they supposed to always be used or necessarily always have to be used evenly across a social network. So to give you an example of how that plays out, imagine these technologies being used during the course of an election, right? One side decides, well, we're going to actually use those pure effects from the James Fowler study, but rather than apply them to all voters to turn out all voters evenly, let's just apply them to a particular political affiliation, right? The other side saying, well, we've also got this bot technology we can use that can be used to target misinformation, but it can also be used to target true facts online. So what happens if we launch technologies to actively sort of inhibit the spread of the meme that people are going out to vote? And I think in that competition, you get something which is actually quite different from sort of traditional PR or communications, and something more akin to sort of quantitative methods and sort of technical work being done at the computer security level now being applied on the social layer. So I only have 5 minutes, so I'm actually almost close to the end of it already. One provocation I want to leave you with is insofar as data plays a big role in the development of these techniques and plays a big role in allowing these techniques to occur, should platforms be sort of cognitively neutral or cognitively secure? That is to say, should they take an active role in making decisions about what sorts of persuasive techniques are allowed? Particularly, how do they do this effectively while respecting sort of rights online, which ends up being this incredibly sort of thorny issue? So I see that my time is already up. So my name is Tim Hwang. Here's my obligatory contact information. Thank you very, very much for your time.
Next up, we have Nick.
Thanks, Dana. Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? My name is Nick Grossman. I'm going to talk about Regulation 2.0. And in small words there, it says bringing an internet approach to real-world regulation. And I use the 2.0 moniker kind of with tongue-in-cheek because in internet land, that's kind of a backwards-facing term. But in regulation land, it's kind of a forward-facing term. And to this room, you know, we're talking about way in the future. So I go into it knowing that. A little bit about me. My day job, I work at a firm called Union Square Ventures. It's a venture capital firm based here in New York City that invests in internet platforms. I also have academic affiliations at the Media Lab and at the Berkman Center, in both cases focusing on tech policy and sort of civic engagement around policy issues. And my background's in the open government, open data space, working with a bunch of nonprofits. USV, we invest in platforms like Twitter and Foursquare and Etsy and Kickstarter that are all, you know, platforms upon which people do economic and social and collaborative activity. And really across all different sectors of the economy. And what I want to talk about today is trust and how in the big, wide, scary internet, we go about creating trust out of nothing with a bunch of strangers. And so when, you know, if you think back at the beginning of the internet, it's this big mass of scary strangers. And over time, we've architected systems that let us collaborate with one another in a variety of ways, whether that's buying something from somebody over eBay, or, you know, giving somebody money for a creative project, or, you know, collaborating on activism or whatever. And the actual architecture of the connections really makes a huge difference when you're talking about getting people to take on new behaviors. This diagram is actually from an MIT study on the social connections required to get people to make substantive changes in their health. And it found that, you know, small, close connections are better than broad, wide connections. And so you can think about the last 15 years of the internet as an experiment in generating trust among strangers. I think about that as, you know, among peers in the network, with the platform itself. Do I trust them to hold my data? Do I trust them to, you know, interact with the government? Do I trust them with my credit card number? And this is an issue that's really come to the forefront in the past, past year. And increasingly, there's this question of building trust with the broader public, sort of the externalities of a network, whether that's a ride-sharing community or a file-sharing community. And the platforms that are doing this architecting are really in the business of creating community, establishing safety, determining how risk and value are allocated, sort of what the rights and responsibilities of themselves and the various actors are. And they really actually get into the business of dealing with privacy, thinking about law enforcement, either within their platform or outside of it, being curators of expression, thinking about how they allow access to data or not. And when you think about it, these are roles that are a lot less like what you would expect from a normal company, and more like what governments tend to do. But of course, they're not governments, for better and for worse. For worse, obviously, because they're not accountable the way that governments are publicly accountable in terms of goals and equity and access and other things. But they're also not bound by some of the constraints that governments are bound by. And so what you've really seen is a massive innovation in the space of regulating economic and collaborative activity on the web. And we've been thinking about it in terms of trust and really in terms of regulatory activity. And to get back to Regulation 2.0, you know, web networks dating back from eBay, you know, up to everything recently, takes an approach that lets tons and tons and tons of people act together at scale, and then uses the data that they generate to hold the individuals accountable and make the system work appropriately. And if you contrast that to the sort of 1.0 model, which is the kind of industrial model of regulation, whether you're talking about the federal government or a city, it's more about erecting barriers to participation, asking for upfront permission and putting friction into the process, which makes a lot of sense if you're thinking about how to establish things like public safety in an era before data and the internet. Let's use a real world example where you're starting to see this come into play more and more every day now. So this is Seattle. This is a bunch of people protesting the city's proposed regulations on ride sharing. I imagine many of you have been following this. Basically, the city, through their own mechanisms and under the sort of influence of other interested actors, have proposed a model of regulating ride sharing, which, without getting into all of them, limits the number of cars, limits the number of hours you can drive, et cetera, a very upfront model. And that's a 1.0 regulatory model. And what if we were, and you see this happen in every industry, what if we were to flip that around and say, rather than apply the 1.0 model to 2.0 industries, we were to apply a 2.0 model to everything else? So what these systems have is, in the case of ride sharing, mobile dispatch, 360-degree peer review. Imagine there was an open API for auditing various aspects of the system's performance. In a lot of ways, that's a much more real-time, much more granular way of understanding the impacts of a system. So the question is, how might you apply that kind of a model to the public sector? That's the framing, and I'll leave you with three challenges that I've been thinking about a lot on these issues that I'd love to get into more. Assuming you think this is basically not a stupid idea, the three issues I've been thinking of are privacy, right? So you're collecting tons and tons of data about how a system works that's never been collected before. That data has the potential to allow the system to flourish. But how and when you share that data with the public sector regulators, whether it's the transportation department, housing department, finance department, is a fraud issue. And you're seeing it crop up in all of the fights between platforms and government, from Airbnb to the ride-sharing companies. Another one, which I think we're going to talk about in the afternoon today, is accountability. You're really getting into this realm of algorithmic accountability and algorithmic regulation. How can we assume that that is not an asymmetrical situation where information and power are accruing in one direction but not available to all? And how do we not just have accountability for participants in the network but also to the platform itself? And the last one that I think about a lot is, if you believe that a transparency and data-driven environment it can allow new things to flourish, how do we also not let that squelch our freedom, our sort of freedom to experiment and try out new things in the full sunlight before we've had a chance as a society to understand them? And those are my three provocations. My name is Nick. Thank you very much, and look forward to the rest of the day.
What I'm worried about is my children. And that should surprise none of you. I have to report. I'm a single parent. I am very stressed all the time. What I'm worried about, not just the generic, how much screen time do they get, how much time do they spend playing indoors versus out, and all the very valid things that parents are concerned about. I'm worried not only about what they see, but what they don't see. I am worried about what David Vladek at Georgetown calls the tyranny of the algorithm. What are the decisions that we are having made? What are the decisions that are forming my children's online habits and offline world in a way that they don't entirely understand or have visibility in? What are the choices that are being made about them? What are the choices that's on? Is that on?
Yes, it is.
Really? It doesn't sound like it is.
What are the choices that are being made about them online? And not just what data is out there, but what are the decisions? Decisions made by government obviously should be our first concern, but decisions made by the private sector about what information they have access to. And so I have two stories, and I call it the insidious decision making of the private sector. My daughter is a first grader at an all-girls Catholic school in Washington, D.C., and I was once a first grader in a Catholic school here in New York City, and that was a long time ago, much longer than most of you probably think. And I remember reading a textbook that said, one day there will be telephones, and you will be able to see the person you're talking to. And this was big futuristic news when I was a first grader and a long, long time ago. And I was telling my daughter this story when she asked why I took this job and why I work in technology. And I said, well, you know, that was the future. The future today was my future 30-something years ago. And she said, Mommy, what does my future look like? And I said, Maggie, your future looks like, you know, rooms with walls that you swipe and the ability to wake up in the morning and say, computer, make me that coffee, or what's my homework assignment today, or whatever your question is of the day. What's my schedule? And talk to it, and touch it, and feel it, and not interact with your computer the way mommy does. You know, my children already have better agility with the touch at screen than I ever will. But her future looks like a world of embedded technology that is so pervasive and so all-encompassing that she will not have a full understanding of what the decisions that are embedded in the algorithm that are informing not just what she sees, but what she does not see, and what information she is not being subject to, and the incredible opportunity for the siloing of information and the siloing of society. That is what I'm concerned about. And this was brought home to me when she turned on the screen of her device, and I won't say what brand name it is, because I don't want to get in trouble with some people I know very well, but the screen was pink. And listen, I don't have a problem with pink. Pink can be a signature color, it's all good, but what I mean is every single book that was offered to her in the algorithm of this app was pink, and it was, for the most part, Barbie. And don't get me started on Barbie. But there was no Jules Verne. There was not even Nancy Drew. The algorithm had decided that a six-year-old girl living in the northeast part of the United States needed to see this limited segment of society. That's not good enough. And that algorithm was probably likely based on what made that company the most money, or perhaps what was most popular in that tranche of people or that age or gender. That's not good enough. That's insidious decision making, and that limits her horizons, that limits her knowledge, that limits the creativity that was mentioned in the previous talk, that limits her experience and her ability to know the world. And so it's very appropriate that we're here in New York City on St. Patrick's Day. My parents moved from Ireland to the United States because they wanted us to expand our horizon. They wanted us to have the full range of opportunity. I don't want that opportunity sliced and diced and narrowed and taken away in a way that is not visible to us. I want her to be able to express her true and full and online and offline digital self, her complete personality and her complete access to information. So I am worried about the tyranny of the algorithm. Thank you.
Thank you. Alex, your turn.
Okay. So I work at the Columbia School for Journalism and the digital journalism bit. I'm one of my colleagues, Nick Diakopoulos, is here. If you're interested in algorithms and algorithm accountability, talk to that guy. So the question is brought here to talk about or to think about is what the role of media is. I'd expand that to the fifth estate now. So all the network civil society, the people on social media and also blogging away have been for some time. Anil Dash is here. I would include him in that world. If we start talking about media and technology, though, I think it's really important to ground that in the history of the space, that the newspapers have been using data for centuries. So if we talk about data-driven journalism or data journalism, this thing that's in the front page, or at least maybe the front of the business page of USA Today today, it's not a new thing. It's been around, and just they used to call it computer-assisted reporting back in the 60s. And now we're starting to look at how the traditional tools that have been applied for journalism, the spreadsheets, the calculators, all these different things, statistical methods applied in social science, the idea of empiricism applied to collecting news, the scientific method looking at whether something is true or not, is being updated, and people like Tim Berners-Lee are excited about it because of all the new opportunities, all the new technologies that can be applied, whether they're online spreadsheets, code sharing on GitHub, agile development applied, cloud storage for processing huge amounts of data, et cetera. So at this moment, 2014, that thing that Tim Berners-Lee was talking about 4 years ago is now our present. There aren't very many people doing it at the real high level, but it's happening. Many more people are becoming literate. The conference I went to in Baltimore a couple weeks ago had nearly 1,000 people there to learn how to do this stuff. It's very clear there's a lot of interest. There's business demand for it. If you go to 538.com, you'll see Nate Silver's new site, which is all about data journalism. He's very excited about it. And some of this stuff is really impressive coming out of NPR, wonderful mobile applications. You notice they've gone to the mobile web. But it's not necessarily, again, completely new. It's grounded. It's looking at the idea that we should be interrogating data as a source, not just people. So instead of a trend where you go out and talk to your three different people you meet in Brooklyn, you might look at 3,000 people that you go to a statistically significant survey, or maybe 30,000 records, or something much larger, to start looking for patterns and analyses. There's some organizations that are doing a really good job of this. ProPublica is one of those places. I see Julia Angwin here in the audience. They're doing impressive stuff on political corruptions and fundraising and really important work in healthcare. The New York Times is a leader in this space looking at things like food security. The Los Angeles Times has done a really important bit of work on ambulance response times using performance data from the agencies themselves and actually seeing where different regions get different responses. The Texas Tribune is showing how it can be done at the state and local level and actually in a productive way, visualizing different dependencies. Down south, La Nación is looking at the political influence, very important form of data analyses. Reuters is doing the same thing to China, trying to analyze where all the influence is in within that society. Never let anyone tell Reuters that metadata isn't quite useful. The Center for Public Integrity has been pioneering this space for a very long time, getting paper records and digitizing them, making them searchable. They're pioneers in the space. So what are some of the big things you should be thinking about coming down the pike? Well, one is absolutely the network reporting of corruption using these methods. Something called offshore leaks, looking at the movement of money around offshore havens. This was provided by a huge dump leaked materials that were then analyzed by over 100 journalists working through many different countries. You can see this phenomenon of reporting in WikiLeaks and other places as well. You can look at the stages of this space. It's not just about getting records from data, that FOIA thing I asked Mr. Podesta about, or actually going and saying, hey, release it, but actually making your own data through scraping or through actually the creation of it. This is also not a new thing. You may be aware that the AP went to Beijing with air particulate collectors. They looked at CO2, they looked at particulate at the Olympics, and were able to actually see the impact of the Chinese government's decisions around their own pollution controls. More recently, you've got the evolution of things like Safecast, where you have civil society and open source hackers getting together and starting to take matters into their own hands of modern radiation data in Japan, and then releasing it online, combine it with government data, and then crowdsource collection. Really important early example of where some of this space could go. And drones. Drones can do more than take pictures. They can also collect data. Imagine drones hovering in lots of new spaces. You can expect that data to be collected by a variety of resources and sources. Obviously, that creates some really interesting privacy questions. If you're a journalist, that also creates really new security questions. If you're collecting data, if you're housing data, if it's sensitive data from government or other entities, it means you have to be much more thoughtful about protecting it just as you would anonymous sources. This is really uncomfortable, and it's gotten so very quickly. If you recognize this map, it's something referred to as the gun map. It's when handgun permit data gotten through FOIA from the New York State was mapped out by a paper. Turned out making that people's names and addresses discoverable on a map around guns got people really upset, and New York State changed the law. So, probably recognize the WikiLeaks data mapped out in Iraq. That was a little bit politically contentious. So was the release of diplomatic cables from the State Department, also mapped. Coming down this space, starting to look at what happens when you have algorithmic redlining, who are the journalists who can find this stuff? Coming down, who can figure out whether there's geographic targeting going on? The Wall Street Journal actually managed to pull that one off. Who can do the research to show where the algorithms are sending the cops to get ahead of the crimes? This is happening in Chicago already. Who can use these same techniques against counterterrorism in the public domain to look through where human tissue tracking is going on? Some other journalists did that too. Who's actually going to connect research, in this case in Africa, into which public health facilities are available at which schools, into activism to get responsive institutions to change the policies themselves. That's where some of this stuff is going. There's just huge questions about who's going to be doing it, where the funding is, what the models, et cetera.
Hello, my name is Mark Latonero. I'm at the USC Annenberg School, and for about 4 years now, our team at the Center on Communication, Leadership, and Policy has been researching the intersection between technology data and human trafficking. So what I'd like to do in the next 5 minutes is to map out some of the terrain surrounding big data and human trafficking, offer a few questions to consider moving forward, and in doing so, I will suggest that in thinking through the data and human trafficking issue, it can provide a framework for understanding future cases where big data is applied to other human rights domains. Human trafficking is a complex issue, but in severe cases, it amounts to when an individual is forced or coerced into prostitution, a minor is involved in commercial sexual activity, victims of forced labor, slavery, or indentured servitude. It's a crime that involves both foreigners, but it's also can involve Americans not being transported anywhere across borders. It involves men, women, girls, and boys, and it causes severe psychological and physical trauma and even death. Now, it's clear that technology has been used to facilitate the sex trafficking of minors. In fact, traffickers, exploiters, and victims all are using the same digital environment that we are using. They're using mobile phones, online classified, social media, chat rooms, et cetera, to recruit, groom, advertise, buy, sell, and control. Yet all of these interactions, as we know, are making trafficking in the online world more visible. It's leaving digital traces of trafficking behavior data with such volume, variety, and velocity that we can observe, collect, and analyze this data in a way we never have before. In fact, one can hypothesize that the digital environment is giving us a window into human trafficking on a scale that we've never seen before. So this presents a unique opportunity to do something important with big data. And Obama said over a year ago, we're turning the tables and we're using technology to go after the traffickers. But let me give you some concrete examples of this. So hidden within a multitude of online classified ads for adult services, we can call that noise, there are a small number of advertisements which is a faint signal indicative of child sex trafficking. And so in each of these posts, there's text, there's a phone number, there's geographic location, and there's an image. And so we're talking about millions of posts, and what one can do is take these posts and extract the information from it. Time, location, geography, text, mobile numbers, et cetera. And so what you hear is a bunch of blue lines, but really what it represents is about is one site, which is on online classifieds in the adult section of in Los Angeles, which is about 3 months of data every day, about 600 posts, about 50,000 posts. Literally, it becomes impossible for law enforcement or others to sift through this data individually. But what one can do is do keyword searches. So these 50,000 posts just in these 3 months sort of can give off data indicative of age, transitor behavior, ethnicity, and nationality. Phone numbers can also be analyzed to infer geographic location. And so one can employ computational linguistics, machine learning techniques on literally terabytes and terabytes of information, millions of posts, and millions of images. Now, a remarkable development is the involvement of the corporate sector in this issue. Companies with access to user or consumer data are uniquely poised to monitor behaviors on their networks, as we all know, networks which are also being exploited by human traffickers. Some examples. Last year, Polaris, a Washington-based organization that runs something called the Human Trafficking Hotline, teamed up with Google Ideas, Palantir, and Salesforce. And what they're doing is they're analyzing about 30 to 40,000 calls that they get each year, and mapping those calls for potential cases of trafficking, as we see here, California, New York, Texas, and Florida get the most calls for trafficking cases. JPMorgan Chase is analyzing millions of transactions, millions of credit card transactions, and are determining a metric of disparate behaviors, which taken together could identify a potential trafficker or a victim, and they're working with federal law enforcement on this. Microsoft Research have created Microsoft Photo DNA, which is matching software originally used in the child pornography realm, and there are folks researching how this technology and other types of image recognition technology can be used to identify ages of the millions of posts that we've been collecting. Now, such partners are certainly advancing our ability to identify human trafficking victims, but there are many outstanding questions. What are the responsibilities associated with the identification of potential victims or perpetrators? Who is responsible for false errors or in identification or predicting behavior? What about the privacy associated with the networks? Who's responsible for bringing these multi-sector actors together? How do we deal with prevention, root causes like privacy, et cetera? How do we deal with rehabilitation? Now, there's no easy answers here, but we have yet to answer even the most basic questions regarding the boundaries, best practices, risks, unintended consequences of tech and data interventions in human trafficking. And I'll just submit to you that if we can address these questions now, it'll give us a head start when we start looking into other human rights domains. Thank you.
Corrine? Sorry. You're next.
Oh, I knew this would happen. Okay, so this is really embarrassing.
Yay.
The only person who will appreciate this is Frank, because I'm not a Mac person, but anyway. Okay, so good morning. Take a look at this picture, and what do you see? Some people will see a vase. Some people will see two faces looking at each other. We see it different ways, but it's still the same picture. That's what I see with big data. You might call this a privacy issue, or you may say it's about criminal justice. You may call this a privacy issue, or you may say it's about financial inclusion. You might call this a privacy issue, or you may say it's about jobs. So I'm Corrine Yu, Managing Policy Director of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights. And 2 weeks ago, a coalition of civil rights and media reform organizations came together to endorse the civil rights principles in the era of big data. For the coalition as a whole, and for many of the organizations that signed, this was a historic first step in the national conversation that's starting now around big data. While our expertise and our passion is civil and human rights, we've been thinking about data and privacy and technology for a long time. Collection of data, such as through the decennial census, is important for documenting persistent inequality and for the enforcement of the civil rights laws. Technology in the form of television brought the civil rights struggles of the South into living rooms everywhere and led directly to the passage of the Voting Rights Act. And surveillance, because the long history of the way surveillance has been used against these communities, has been an issue of great concern over the years. So now we're starting to see big data, privacy, technology come up all across the civil rights landscape. And whether we use the language of big data, privacy, or civil rights, we're looking at many of the same questions. Big data can and should bring greater safety and economic opportunity and convenience to all people. At their best, these new tools are about equal opportunity and equal justice. They can shed light on inequality and discrimination and can bring more clarity and objectivity to the important decisions that guide people's lives. But we also see some risks. Discrimination and injustice are still embedded in our society. They are reflected in the data we're talking about today, and in credit histories and housing patterns, in arrest records, and so on down the line. So to guard against these risks, we've highlighted five key principles for civil rights in the era of big data. So the first principle is stop high-tech profiling. First, we know that surveillance technology is becoming cheaper than ever for law enforcement at all levels, and communities of color are often the first places where these new surveillance techniques appear. The debate over how widely to use these tools is still evolving, but we know that racial profiling and discrimination are wrong, regardless of whether they're high-tech or low-tech. We need clear rules of the road, and we need people to be accountable for how these systems are used. Principle two is ensuring fairness in automated decisions. Big data is making big choices in people's lives, deciding who gets a job or a loan or a favorable insurance quote. We need to make sure that these systems don't reinforce existing inequalities. We need to make sure that landmark civil protections like fair lending, fair housing, equal employment opportunity continue to be protected even as technologies change. Principle three is preserve constitutional principles. Big data cannot be allowed to undermine the Bill of Rights. Communities of color and racial and religious and ethnic minorities have often faced disproportionate scrutiny from law enforcement that makes search warrants and other independent oversight of law enforcement particularly important for these groups. Government databases must not be allowed to undermine core legal protections, including those of privacy and freedom of expression. Principle four, enhance individual control of personal information. We know that personal information held by companies can reveal the intimate details of people's lives. Some of what they know is sensitive, and there are real risks of abuse that we need to be vigilant about. People should have meaningful, flexible control over how a company gathers data from them and how the company uses and shares that data. Data that isn't public shouldn't be shared with the government except through the judicial process. Principle five is protect people from inaccurate data. We need to protect people from inaccurate data. The more decisions are data-driven, the more important accuracy becomes. Big organizations may be the stewards of big data, but each of us needs the chance to make sure that when information about us is used to shape our lives, that information is accurate. Equal opportunity and equal justice are values that we all share. This affects all Americans. If we're going to protect those values and make them stronger, we need to make sure that civil rights issues are on the agenda and that the civil rights community has a seat at the table. That's why I'm so glad to be here today. I hope that this can be the start of a great conversation, and the civil rights community is eager to engage with you all. Thank you.
Hi there. So my current research interests are in the rise of self-tracking devices and applications, but I thought I would talk to you today in my fire starter about other tracking, drawing on my prior research, which was on the gambling industry. And what I want to look at through this case, I'm an anthropologist, so I like to think through specific cases, is how big data-driven technologies can operate as the means to different ends. So in this case, tracking for profit and tracking for protection, ends that are seemingly in tension. So first, tracking for profit. Nearly 75%, I think it might be 80% now, of gamblers today in the US are gambling with player cards, so they are being tracked. These so-called loyalty programs, you sort of have to use a card to play. In some jurisdictions, you can't play without a card. And the information, you of course get redeemable points based on your volume of play. And the casino gets a wealth of information. I like to think of it as bonuses for bites. Information such as not only your wins and losses and how many bets you make, but the rate at which you are pressing the button, all sorts of data, how much you come, what hours, what does your spouse play, et cetera.
These systems, I should say, were modeled after the frequent flyer programs in the 1980s, but they quickly surpassed those programs in terms of the volume of behavioral. This is sort of key, almost like laboratory key press data that is being collected. I should also say that this happened before internet companies like Amazon and Google and Facebook became famous for their innovations in customer monitoring and marketing. Here's just a couple of comments on that from inside the gambling industry. The unique advantage of our industry is that we have hundreds of touch points a week or month, thousands a year. It's a profuseness of data you don't find in other areas. I think that was from 1991, that quote. And here we have one more closer to today. We've got 20,000 behavioral models per second streaming off the floor. So in order to cope with that kind of atomic level of data streaming off the casino floor and extract meaningful insight from it, increasingly the industry is turning to behavioral intelligence software suites. I'm not going to get into the details here, but really being able to drill down into individual icons who are on the floor and see information immediately about them, and then, of course, figure out ways to more profitably market to patrons, not just through the mail, but often in real time. So a real-time adjustment could be sending instant bonuses to the machines or adjusting the sort of game selection on the floor. I wanted to show you this. This is one such system. It's called C-Power, and it promises to help casinos cope with all of this information. What it does is it transforms all of that data into these colorful heat maps. I'll just show you what it looks like animated. Video is not playing. Well, just imagine it sort of swelling and growing. When casino managers looked at this particular image over 5 days, they found this pattern, or rather, the system directed their attention to a pattern where on a certain bank of slot machines, women under 30 were playing a lot and then suddenly moving around to the other side of the bank and then leaving. Then they sent actual scouts out to watch what might be happening on the floor at the time. And it turned out that a sort of sexy review show was ending at around that time, and men over 50 were bothering the women. So what did they do? They built what they call the slot shelter, a protective area for these women, marketed this area to them. And then, of course, the happy story is that revenue then doubles from these particular customers. This is another map that isn't animated. This one is called Ground Floor Little Old Ladies Carded Playing Time, and it's a way to sort of superimpose data from women over 50 onto a map. I think this is Sydney, I'm not sure. And it's registering their home addresses and showing where, and it seems that after church on Sunday, there's a giant blossoming in the revenue that's deriving from this particular demographic. And so then one can tailor the game selection, the denomination to, because most of game content now is downloadable, so let's reconfigure the floor to be 5 cents with certain kinds of games on Sunday morning. All right, protection. How are these kinds of technologies being used for protection? In some jurisdictions, not yet in the US, but it's likely coming here soon, these systems are equipped with algorithms which are using this very same data. So it's not like a separate system, it's running on the same data collection system, and they're using that in order to detect problematic gambling behavior and then prompt real-time intervention in that rather than real-time marketing. So it's kind of this interesting tension in two kind of programs running at the same time. Here's advertising material from one such program. And the way it works, this algorithm was developed out of 2 years of very robust player tracking data that a casino had. This was in Saskatchewan. And it isolated over 500 relevant behavioral variables. So things like the number of machines played, total session times, again, the speed of pressing on buttons, days of weeks played, et cetera. Then as a player plays, this historical data is compared to their real-time data. And if any slide is noticed that looks like this person is beginning to gamble in an out of control or problematic way, the marketing system will then be frozen, the card will be deactivated, and an in-house gambling counselor will be dispatched to the machine to talk to the person and engage them in a conversation. So what's the motivation here? in part because Canadian casinos are run by the state. There's definitely more of a sense of duty of care, and that is how it is phrased. However, if you look carefully at duty of care, right after this, normalizing interactions as part of good customer service and ultimately financial sustainability, what's going on here is that a lot of these casinos cater to local residents, and these are customers you don't want to tap out. In fact, you can derive the most money from them if you keep them for life. And the way to do that is not an abstinence model, but normalizing interactions with them. The counselor brings them into the back room and they talk about ways to budget. So it's not you are addicted, leave forever. It's how can we work with you to get you more in a kind of comfortable, healthy threshold of gambling. Something similar I thought I would mention is going on in the online gambling space. This hasn't been applied yet, but the technology exists. And here it's much more boldly phrased as a question. Yes, it's protection. Down here we see longer, safer, et cetera, but higher overall revenue. It's really about retaining players by anticipating their vulnerability and extending their life. Their life meaning the amount of time they're going to spend in casinos giving over money. So revenue driven is really the aim here. So we have come full circle. There's this slippage between profit and protection, protection and profit. The case of player tracking in the gambling industry I find instructive, not only because it shows us how a single technology can be used for these two aims, but the ways in which these aims actually fold into one another. And the lesson here seems to be that when one and the same stakeholder is left in charge of both ends, the task of protection can come to function less as a check on persuasion and more as a way to enhance persuasion. And what might at first appear to be a tension reveals itself to maybe be more of a collusion. And this sort of conclusion, which is clearly not specific to the gambling industry, it's in many sectors, I think does call for some sort of oversight, which would take into account the motivations of those who are performing the persuasion, the profiting, the protection, and perhaps insist on some sort of firewall between the two. My very last slide, what might such a firewall look like? Definitely imperfect, but this is a statute that I wrote, and to my great surprise, is now part of the gambling bill in Massachusetts, gambling yet to come. But it was written in the spirit of transparency and accountability and public availability of data. The casinos will have to turn over all their data to the commission, who will in anonymized form and make it available to researchers, and also data on the games. So the idea was to have a symmetry between player tracking and product tracking. Then you can begin to look at what products are problematic and take that evidence to regulators. And I'll stop there, thank you.
Thank you all to an invigorating and exciting morning already. Hopefully this has given you lots of fun things to have conversations about. I'm a big believer in making certain that people are fed early and often. So I am going to break and make certain that we get to eat, but it's also a great opportunity for everybody to start to mix and match. As you've gotten to see, there's already a diversity of people even up front today. We will have lots more conversations for the rest of the day. But please take the moment during lunch, see your friends, be excited to see the people you haven't seen in a while, but also get to know some new people. At this point, we're going to transition downstairs for some food. There is going to be a baseline security here, which means I would say leave coats and random things here, but probably not laptops. And that's probably a good balance, but feel free to leave, the general stuff here. We will have food. There are tables set up for you to have conversations. And then let's try to be back here at 1:00. Thanks, guys.